All right, so in this video, we're going to talk about how to develop preeminence in your community. And ultimately, it's about becoming known as the go-to health provider so that you are top of mind in the community when it comes to a certain health condition. Now, I truly believe that integrative functional naturopathic practitioners are the future of healthcare, but the only way this can happen is when they are known for what they do. They can't just be a great healer. And so this is obviously especially critical in an area of medicine where people are looking for exactly this type of approach, but don't know it exists. And even if they've heard of functional medicine, they don't know what that means. And because they don't know what it means, and they don't know how it can help them, they're not taking action. And so we're sort of stuck between a rock and a hard place if we are not known for a certain type of result, for a certain type of service that helps people. Now, the goal for this session is to help you understand the key ingredients to be known as a health leader in your community. So long before somebody ever steps into your practice, so that it's easier to enroll new patients, that patients understand the value that you provide, that you can charge what you know you're worth, and you can get patients better clinical outcomes because they're more invested in the type of care plan that you develop for them, because they understand that you are the expert and that they should really pay attention to your leadership. Now, let's explain what preeminence is. It's about positioning yourself in the mind of the consumer so that they want to do business with you because they know that you are the one for them. And you want to be seen by everyone you deal with as the definitive expert source and the most trusted advisor that has their best interests at heart. You don't want to come across as a generic seller of services. And this is a critical point because it is not about convincing people that they have to work with you. It's about pre-educating them so that they want to do business with you, that they want to enlist in your care. And so that allows you to not having to push, not having to be salesy. You can just be authentically yourself, feel good about your message and the services that you provide in your community. So my promise is that your time today will be worth it for the following three reasons. Number one, we're going to talk about what to post on social media to be seen as the go-to expert. Number two, we talk about aligning your website copy to position you as the preeminent provider. And number three, we're going to talk about how to nurture your prospects via email and videos to the point where they know, love, and trust you enough to request an appointment. So diving right in, you know, number one, what to post on social media. You know, the one thing that we have to sort of recognize is that the content that you post on social media, on your website, in your emails, in your videos, in your workshop, is taken as a substitute by your audience to determine what kind of experts you are and whether they should work with you. So in the absence of meeting you in person, they use the content that you put out there to make that judgment. And this is where perception is reality. You know, for them, it doesn't actually matter what degrees you had, where you went to school, what your residency was, you know, what your services actually are. They just take what they see quite literally and make a determination based on that. So they judge the book by its cover. And so if you don't control what that perception is, then you have no way to influence it. And again, this is about being able to persuade them, to pre-educate them about you know, what you stand for so that they can make an informed decision to work with you. So oftentimes working with integrative naturopathic and functional medicine practitioners, I find that they are unsure what to post on social media. And I know it's hard to be creative on the spot if you don't have a framework to follow. I'm in the exact same boat that, you know, if you ask me, you know, write a couple social media blog posts, you know, it takes me forever to come up with something good. So I am following a framework that I'm sharing with you that helps you sit down once a week, map out the content that you want to post that week, and then be very efficient with your time, as well as leverage a virtual assistant and your team so you don't have to be doing everything yourself. So here's really the challenge when it comes to content marketing, because that's really what it is, educational content marketing. You use content and education to market to your audience. You educate them, you provide advanced value before they even come into your practice. And so because you deliver that value to them, that's why they're much more likely to interact with you. So the problem is really that as a practitioner, you're incredibly knowledgeable. You can talk about so many different things. You can talk about nutrition, you can talk about gut health, you can talk about cognition, about autoimmunity, about metabolic health, about hormones. You know, it's all interlinked. The blood goes everywhere. So obviously, as a functional integrative medicine practitioner, you are very well versed in this. And that is really your Achilles heel when it comes to content marketing, because it actually doesn't matter what you want to talk about, what you want to say. The more important part is, what is your audience looking for? And likely, that's a small fraction of what you could be talking about. And, you know, that is the sweet spot of what you have to talk about. You know, what are they looking for? So talk about this. And then once they are in your ecosystem, once they're your patient, you can then talk about anything else that's not in that, overlapping segment that it may be relevant to their case. But when we first put the content out there, you want to stay in that sweet spot for your content marketing, because people will take what you post about as a substitute for your expertise, and that will prompt them to actually realize that you are the one. So, you know, the first step is really identifying your core topic. You know, you could say it could be your clinical niche, but ultimately it is about, from a marketing angle, you know, what is it that you are known to talk about? And it's almost like being a politician running for office. You know, what is your platform? What do you stand for? What, you know, and because you constantly talk about the same content, you sort of drill it into people's head that this is what you can help them with. And so, you know, again, two great examples from our community are Dr. Sarah DiFrancesco and Dr. Jolene Brighton. So if you haven't looked at their social media profiles, at their Instagram accounts, take a look at it. And what you'll recognize is that they stick to their guns. They stick to topic. And based on the topics that they talk about, it makes it very easy for you to understand whether they are the right one for you. Now, this can be daunting. So, you know, in this entire process, and we talked about this in previous videos, you know, as a lead practitioner, you don't have to execute all of this tasks that are involved in this. You know, your role is really at the very beginning to come up with a content calendar that sort of maps out, here's all the topics I could be talking about, and maybe chunk that down based on a set of weekly topics that you're highlighting. And so again, Michael Kay is a great example that of a practitioner that's practicing that. Then, you know, your other role is to create the weekly blog post or weekly video. So assume that you only post one video a week. Sit down on a Saturday or a day of the week that you set aside for content creation, write that blog post or create that video, and then you can turn it over to your virtual assistant to post-produce the video, to create quote cards, to schedule it to Facebook, to your Facebook group, Twitter, Pinterest, Instagram, LinkedIn, if it's a video, to YouTube and your blog. But, and then obviously you could also send a weekly recap email to your existing list where you point out all the social media things that you posted during that week. So again, this is something that you don't have to do in order to arrive at a content marketing plan that looks like this. You know, you only have to create that seed content, and then the virtual assistant and your social media team can repurpose this into daily nuggets and smaller chunks. So, you know, you could take pieces from your blog post and post a snippet on Monday. You can take another piece, post that on Tuesday, take a third piece, post it on Wednesday, etc. And then there you go. You have the content for your week. So this is about, you know, what needs to happen on social media. This is the first touch point that the people in your community probably have with your content. And, you know, yes, it is a lot of work, but, you know, I wanted to sort of point out a recent social media post by Melanie Functional Media. You know, she asked, which doctor would you pick? I'm going to read this quickly. Imagine you're faced with a choice between two doctors. Dr. Smith has no social media presence. The other doctor, Dr. Jones, has a robust presence on social media. And you might be thinking that social media has nothing to do with a doctor's competence, and you're absolutely right. But there are some hidden psychological factors at play that influence people's choices of which doctor they go with. And so, you know, what Melanie points out is that giving value through social media triggers the human instinct to reciprocate. It's called the reciprocity principle. And, you know, they reciprocate by paying attention and by, you know, checking out your workshop and or becoming a client. And so again, Dr. Smith has provided the prospect with zero value versus Dr. Jones' Instagram feed is stuffed with value adding and educational posts that already helped the prospect begin changing their life, change their mindset that resolution is possible. And again, subject that is already sort of moving the needle in that person's direction. You know, what have you done for me? Well, Dr. Jones already has done a lot. Then next, you know, point that she makes is subject authorities are always desired. So again, Dr. Smith might be knowledgeable, but the prospect can't tell because there's no content out in the public domain that helps you determine what the subject matter expertise is, right? On the other hand, Dr. Jones not only shows the expertise with high-value posts, but also showcases dozens of testimonials or case studies how they have helped patients. And again, if you're taking a look at, for instance, Tara Scott's social media feed, she always mentions saying, you know, when we work with patients, this is what we do. And then number three, people tend to be consistent with their previous actions. So, you know, Dr. Smith has never had an interaction with a prospect versus Dr. Jones has received 23 likes, 6 comments, and a discovery call from a prospect. That person is far more likely to stay consistent with their prior actions and become a client, right? Why else would they go from Dr. Jones to Dr. Smith? You know, they're saying, well, Dr. Jones, I already know, is a known quantity, has already shown me that he knows what he's talking about and has demonstrated that he's doing exactly the type of care that I'm looking for. So in the prospect's mind, there's no reason to switch and go to Dr. Smith, right? And then finally, social proof is a critical factor in making choices. So Dr. Smith has zero social proof. Dr. Jones has, you know, a rich history of positive testimonials, engagement on their social media. It's a safe bet to go with Dr. Jones based on what other people have said. And then ultimately, Melanie points out is the more aesthetic option usually wins. So Dr. Smith has an out-of-date budget website from 10 years ago. Dr. Jones has an Instagram feed that's really rich, has great images and well-written posts. So again, quality when it comes to social media will then be extrapolated to the quality of your clinical care. You know, if a doctor has not bothered to update their website, that doctor has probably not bothered to update their clinical knowledge either. And that's is not true, but that's what's going on in the audience's mind. So I really like this post, you know, because it really highlights why social media and what you post on your website is so critical. All right, so next, aligning your website copy with your expertise. So again, when it comes to your website copy, it's important to be focused on your audience, helping them make the decision, helping them see how you're the expert. And so on the homepage, you have to start talking about what's most relevant to them. Start with where they're at, with their problems, where they're stuck, and create empathy. It's not about telling them about your services and, you know, how you take their money. It's really about just being of service to them in the same way you do this on social media. On the about page, you need to convey your positioning, and you could talk about your expertise and experience, but position that in the through the lens of their what they're looking for. So don't use a lot of technical jargon. Don't use a lot of names of procedures and services that you do. It's all about how you can help them, people like them. And so you may put testimonials or case studies on that about page as well so that they understand it's not, even though the about page is about our practice, it's really about them, why they should make the decision to work with you. Again, services. Convey your simple three-step approach. It's just enough for them to feel that they're in the right place, that you are able to handle that problem. They don't want to know the nitty-gritty, the 192-point inspection list that you take them through. That's only going to confuse them. So again, we want to make it easy for them to decide, yep, this sounds like the right person. Let's take the next step. And then ultimately, your blog post, just like your social media post, have to be relevant to your positioning. So if you are a digestive health specialist, you should really only talk about digestive health and link whatever you talk about to digestive health. So yes, you can talk about maybe cognition, but you have to frame it through the lens of digestive health so that people understand everything is connected to digestive health. Also, it's important to ensure with your blog post that we cross-link to lead magnets throughout. That means, you know, we provide people a way to get on your email list, because ultimately your website alone will not be enough to convince them in a one session to, you know, select you as their new provider. So again, we have to have a vehicle to get in touch with them over and over again until they're ready. And so what we call a lead magnet is really very important. And so here's a checklist for lead magnets. As I said, to get more people on your mailing list, we need to use what's called a lead magnet. That could be a report, a guide. It could be a cheat sheet or a quick start guide. It could be a toolkit or resource list. It could be a decision guide, or it could be a quiz, survey, or assessment. So there's multiple ways to go about it. Ultimately, the important part is that the lead magnet is related to the outcome. You know, the lead magnet needs to help you identify that this person is the right fit for my clinic. So again, does your lead magnet tie into a known outcome? And so in this case, for instance, these are two lead magnets that are probably good for a practitioner helping people with digestive health, because these are topics that identify to you that this person is somebody worried about aspects of their digestive health. Lead magnets will be most effective in your patient acquisition funnel if they are relevant to your services. You know, as I mentioned on the previous page, you know, a digestive health lead magnet needs to tie into a digestive health clinical program. They need to be ultra specific to a symptom or diagnosis that your prospects experience, and they can't be just an information dump. They really have to sort of start revitalizing your prospect's mind. They need to contain your wisdom to give them a lay of the land and help them understand that what they're currently doing is not moving the needle. And so this could be educating about why their conventional practitioner is not really helping them the way that you could, and, you know, point out that difference. Ultimately, the lead magnet needs to be easily consumed in 2-3 minutes. So we want to ensure that people are opting in for this, that they're, you know, in their mind, they're thinking, okay, I can easily consume this in 2-3 minutes. It's not a 100-page ebook that I don't have time to read, right? So it needs to be easily consumed, and, you know, it should be integrated with your email follow-up. And so this is what I would say is sort of critical for your website. You know, the next part of establishing preeminence is involving email and video. So the reason why email and video is so important is that the overarching idea of preeminence is to establish yourself in the minds of your ideal patients as the solution that they've been looking for all along. And so this is very hard to pull off in a single website visit, because just like in dating, it takes a series of dates until you can pop the question. And you know, ultimately, they want insights, you want connection and a bond. And so video does both. You can deliver the information that you're looking for, but at the same time, you are creating a bond. They get to see you, they get to hear you. And ultimately, email delivers information in a sequenced manner. So you control the order in which people consume the content. So here's an example from Sachin Patel. You know, he has a 30 ways in 30 days sequence. And what these emails look like is that in the email, you have a number of links, a link at the top of the email to link to the video. You have a thumbnail of a video that links to the video. And then you have short actionable copy below. And again, this is a video that sits as an unlisted video somewhere on your website. You can host it on Vimeo or YouTube and then embed it on your website. But, you know, when people click through from the email, they go back to your website, watch the video, and hopefully browse around some more. And so for those of you that are sort of more visually oriented, this is what a 10 ways in 10 days email sequence looks like. So there's a number of opt-ins that identify that that person is somebody interested, let's say, in digestive health. They go to a common thank you page where you welcome them. And then over the next 10 days, you deliver a series of emails with a link to a video in it. And so that is how you establish preeminence. And now you essentially, if you count the website visit with it, this is now 11 touch points that you have. And the idea is that over those 11 touch points, you demonstrate the value that you could bring to their life. You differentiate yourself from conventional or family practitioners in your community so people understand what you bring to the table that other practitioners may not. And you ultimately establish authority and expertise so people see that it's a safe bet working with you. Now, there's many more ways you can expand your preeminence after you have established your ground game on social media, your website, and your email autoresponder, as we discussed so far. And in the order of pulling this off, I would start with testimonials and case studies. Again, other people talking about you and talking to the results that you have accomplished for them is a powerful way to edify your expert status. And so this is a very easy way to get started. Now, next, our phone consultation. Obviously, when people get on the phone with you, you can now further your preeminence. Now, this is maybe not the best way to create preeminence in the first place, but it is a part of, you know, expanding your preeminence and anchoring it in. And in conjunction with this, we have something what we call a pre-phone consultation mini webinar, which is a 15 to 20 minute video that goes over how your practice operates. And you know, it's called mini webinar for a reason, because it does a lot of the heavy lifting in terms of establishing preeminence and showcasing what you can do that makes it more likely for people to take action. Next, webinars and workshops in your community are powerful ways to create preeminence. And again, what we're talking about mostly is about creating preeminence at the local level so that you are known as the one practitioner to go to for a certain condition, but obviously it can work on a nationwide audience as well. So workshops is a powerful tool. Meetups is another fantastic way to anchor in preeminence. You know, at the Evolution of Medicine, we have what's called the Functional Forum Meetups, where if you are the meetup host, you're automatically a very important person in your community that is bringing together a community of like-minded practitioners to talk about advanced topics in integrative functional medicine. And so that's one way to establish preeminence. Another way is through podcasts and interviews. So whether these are interviews on Facebook Lives, it could be a podcast series where you just take the audio portion of your interviews. You know, this is, again, if you are a podcast host, that means, you know, you're an important person, you have a message to share with the world. And so again, that makes you an expert. And then on the right-hand column, you can see other examples to create and expand preeminence, including referrals with complementary providers in your community. You could be writing a book, and you know, the book doesn't have to be hundreds of pages, it could be an 80-page book. But again, as a published author, that again creates preeminence, and that could be the reason why you get on certain podcasts, why you are included in certain events in your community, because you're a published author and expert. Ultimately, it's about speaking engagement as well. So if you get invited to speak at other people's event that already have collected an audience of people that you could serve, you know, that's a powerful way to create preeminence. And finally, you could host your own live event. These are all ideas that work in conjunction with the three strategies that we talked about in the beginning. And you know, the more of these you add to your arsenal, the faster your preeminence grows. But you have to start somewhere. And in my mind, you know, starting on social media, your website, and your email autoresponder are the three most logical places to start, because that is part of your patient attraction funnel. This is what's working 24/7. This is how people come across your brand. And so we want to make sure that people get the right information along this, whereas all these other things, their add-ons, the testimonials go on your website, the phone consultation are available from your website, the webinars are on your website, and then obviously these other elements, meetups, podcasts, referrals, book, those are sort of not attached to these three items. Obviously, you can use your email list to publicize them, but they're going a little bit beyond the framework that I think most practitioners should focus on first. I hope this resonates with you. If you need help to decide on the next best step to establish preeminence, I would be happy to jump on a call with you, offer a free 30-minute strategy session where we review your goals for preeminence, you know, see how you can establish yourself as the go-to expert in your community. And if it makes sense to you, we can talk about partnering together on your preeminence marketing. So if that's you, go to bigboost.marketing/apply and see you on a call.